Hello, this is Wayne Fuquay, professor of psychology at Western Michigan University. Welcome to the next installment in our Michigan Autism Video Training Series. We're very fortunate today to have Dr. Mary Jane Weiss. Mary Jane is a professor of psychology at Endicott College in Beverly, Massachusetts, where she's also the director of graduate training in applied behavior analysis and autism. In addition to that, Mary Jane has been a practicing professional for a number of years in the discipline and has done a lot of work in particular in the area of social skills training. So Mary Jane, welcome to our video. Very nice to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
Great. Now, we're going to talk today about social skills and social skills assessment and training, especially as it applies in the autism area. Can we start off, first of all, by talking about why is this an important topic in autism? What is the social skills autism connection? What would you like our audience to know about that?
Sure. Social skills deficits are a defining characteristic of autism spectrum disorder. And so, by definition, we have to put a lot of our clinical attention to addressing those core deficits. Just like we know that communication deficits are part and parcel of autism spectrum disorders, so are social skills deficits. It just is something that we don't see happen without a great deal of specific individualized instruction. So because of that sort of centrality as a diagnostic feature, we really need to focus on it from an instructional perspective.
Makes good sense. And the bottom line is, and without some sort of assessment and intervention that's effective, those social skills may not develop. Is that what we would assume?
Oh, without intervention, they are not likely to get better by themselves.
Okay. How serious a handicap is that, or how serious a problem is that for a person going forward?
I think social skills deficits are really centrally important in terms of how we think about making socially significant changes for individuals on the autism spectrum, because they're the kinds of deficits that get people into trouble. They're the kinds of things that for adults with autism, there might be productivity problems on a job. Those are not the reasons why people on the autism spectrum generally lose employment. People on the autism spectrum lose employment because of social skills deficits, because of behaviors that people find uncomfortable or unusual. And so I think if we don't address those behaviors when we're working with children with autism, we end up with adults with autism that have those deficits that really get them into problem situations.
Interesting. So those deficits carry over into adulthood and create some barriers to quality of life, it sounds like.
Definitely.
Do they also have an impact earlier in a person's life in terms of friendships, potential to be teased or bullied, or is that also part of the connection too?
Definitely. Definitely in terms of looking at young children and school-age children and into adolescence, at every stage, looking at social skill evolution and development is really important. And to the extent that a person isn't equipped to manage the social demands of their environment, they're much more likely to be isolated, probably in young years, but later to be bullied, to be marginalized, and to express feelings of loneliness as well, to sometimes feel that that effect quite prominently in their own experience.
Well, it sounds like a terribly important domain to work on to improve quality of life. Now, let me ask what may sound like a naive question, but I'd be interested in your reaction to it. Is a defining feature of autism? Isn't this just something that you've got to accept as a characteristic of autism? Or is part of your message that, wait a minute, this is malleable. This is something in spite of the autism diagnosis that people can improve upon and dramatically change over the course of a lifetime?
I think that's a great question. You know, you could make the same argument for every other defining characteristic of autism. So we look at the triad of symptoms, right? We know that there are communication deficits. We know that there are social deficits. We know there are behavioral excesses and difficulties. We have to tackle all of them. Every one of them needs intensive treatment, and all of them can be improved. But I think you're hitting upon something really interesting. And I think it's true that we are hesitant or maybe less robust in our efforts to address the social deficits. And I think part of the reason for that is that it is harder to address some of these deficits than it is to do other kinds of instruction. You know, we're not hesitant to teach individuals with autism a variety of pre-academic and academic and other skills that they need to have in their repertoires. But when we hit social skills, we sometimes are a bit overwhelmed, I think, as clinicians about how to approach this. The deficits are so global and the outcomes are so remote from where this person is at this point in time that I think it's sometimes difficult to know where do I begin? How do I take this person to a level where they'll be engaging in functional social skill development? And I think that that is part of our hesitation, is just the enormity of the task.
So what it sounds like you're saying is that in many ways social skills are more complicated than some of the skills that we can learn almost as a rote skill or a chain of responses. Like you could learn to develop or to follow a recipe and make a cake, but social skills are really specific in terms of the context and maybe even in terms of reading how people are reacting to your social skills, if they're looking confused, if they're losing eye contact with you because you've lost their interest in what you're saying, whole range of things like that. So those sound like there's a lot of subtle contextual and social interaction cues that need to control the behavior.
Absolutely. I think they're extraordinarily complex for exactly those reasons. And I think that we try to capture enough variability that's likely to reflect the kinds of things someone's going to encounter in their natural experiences, but it's hard. And we're not necessarily going to capture enough of those things to prepare them for everything they might encounter. And so there's some art to the science of how we do it to try to guess as best as we can how to best prepare them for the myriad of situations they're likely to encounter.
So, Mary Jane, you make a case that these social skills are complex and contextual. Can you elaborate a little bit? What is there about the social skills that are so complex, especially when compared with other skill sets that you might train?
Sure, they are extraordinarily complex. It really is very different from teaching a more circumscribed skill like color identification or something like that. Here we have skills that are really multi-element skills. We could take any skill that you would consider to be a social skill. Lining up for recess, for example, learning to take your turn in a game. Those are not skills that are unidimensional. Those aren't simply taught where we have a quick definition of it and we can target it and teach to it. We actually have many, many skills comprising those skills. We could probably make a list of 10 or 15 skills for each of those skills, lining up for recess or taking a turn in a game. It's not just one skill. Those composite skills have lots of components. So to effectively teach someone how to follow the rules associated with lining up for recess is a very complex procedure with a lot of different component parts. So one piece of it is that these skills are truly multidimensional skills, multi-element skills. And that in and of itself increases the complexity and the time frame that we need to devote to teaching them. But it's also that in addition to that, they involve social judgment. So we have to always be factoring in with social skills, contextual cues, contextual relevance. What's going on in this situation? Who am I talking to? What exactly is this context? You and I do that 100 times a day in our dealings with people in our lives. If you run into somebody in the hallway at your place of employment on Monday morning for the first time, I see you after a weekend. I say, Wayne, hello, how are you? How was your weekend? What did you do? We exchange information about our weekends. An hour and a half later, I pass you in the hall again. I'm filling up my coffee cup. I don't say, Wayne, how are you? How was your weekend? What did you do? Because I know we've already had that conversation. I factor that in. I'm going to have a much simpler, briefer interaction with you. As the day goes on, we might just be waving or smiling to each other in the hallway because we don't need to keep talking at that level. That's social judgment. That's me realizing that this is a conversation we already had. This is a greeting that's already transpired. Now we're just going to smile and wave. Those kinds of things are very, very hard to convey to an individual on the autism spectrum. They may learn the greet and interact, but they're likely, when they see you at 10:30 for the second time, to say, "Wayne, how are you? How was your weekend? What did you do?" Even though they know the answers to those questions, and that conversation's already occurred.
Sounds almost like, in that case, is an example of almost a rote, memorized social skill, and it would not be contextually sensitive. And if I am understanding correctly, it sounds like there's a lot of contextual variables that might be operational. For example, the loudness of my voice at a soccer game would differ dramatically than my loudness of voice in talking in a theater or in a funeral or something of that nature.
Absolutely.
And knowing something about the history that we've shared, we've just had this conversation, or maybe you and I saw a similar movie or shared an experience, you know, at a, you know, something, a concert, talking about that. So you need to have that sense of history and context to have a meaningful discussion.
Absolutely. And the fact that I have that history with you changes the way you and I talk about it. If I talk to somebody with whom I don't have that history, I have an entirely different conversation.
Lost, yes, absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
And so all of that is very nuanced. Mm-hmm. It's also not something that you needed to be taught or that I needed to be taught or that we need to actually teach typically developing children. It's that unwritten social curriculum that typically developing individuals pick up on without instruction. But we have to find a way to make that relevant and comprehensible to individuals who don't pick that up naturally.
So let's start there, okay? How do we begin as a behavior analyst to identify the social skills excesses and deficits that might be of concern? What is your suggestion for our first steps in these particular areas, Mary Jane?
Well, first I would say that it's pretty overwhelming to a lot of behavior analysts. When it reminds me of what behavior analysts encounter with behavioral excesses. You have a list of, you know, 15 behaviors that all ought to get your attention over time. But you can't target 15 behaviors. You have to figure out which ones are most interfering with this individual's quality of life, and you have to target those. In the same way, we can easily overwhelm ourselves with the social deficits and with a list of social skills that we ought to be targeting for this individual, but we can't teach 15 of them at a time either. So we have to start with the most fundamental ones, with the areas that are going to give the greatest impact for that individual from a social skills perspective. In recent years, a lot of attention's been given to the realm of social communication, and in particular, teaching manding skills or requesting skills. And that is an excellent area for us to initially focus on, especially with young learners. But very often when I talk to behavior analysts who are working with young learners, and I say, "What are you doing in the realm of social skills instruction?" They say, "Well, we're not actually targeting social skills yet," or, "He's not really up to that yet. We're at much more fundamental skills." And I say, "Like what?" And they say, "Well, we're working on manding, and we're working on imitation, and we're working on play." And I think it does not get more social than that. Those are all social skills, every one of them. And the way in which we teach those are going to make a very long-term difference in this person's social skill outcome. So I think part of it is also our own framework with how we're approaching instruction, that many of those early cornerstone skills are fundamentally social in nature. And I think it's really important to recognize that.
It's interesting you talk about them as early cornerstones. So you're almost, if I'm reading you right, think of along the lines of a hierarchy on which you build skills with basic things like imitation, attending to social cues, manding, or some of the fundamental skills on which you build more sophisticated skills. Is that a fair way to say, do you think?
Absolutely. Think about imitation in particular. So imitation training, you are teaching a person to watch and do. And we start at the simplest version of that. But ultimately, what's your goal? Your goal is to have them be able to use observational learning, to watch what a peer in a classroom is doing to figure out what they should be doing, to watch how a peer in an employment situation is navigating a particular challenge and navigate the challenge in that same way. It's a problem-solving skill that we're giving people in terms of use your environment and the people in it to give you information about what to do.
You know, you describe this remarkably complex, context-sensitive set of skills. And that presents some interesting challenges about saying, what are our benchmarks? What skills should we train? And I'm wondering whether or not looking at other similar-aged or similar-developmentally-aged peers, does that give us any clues as to what we should be trying to train for children on the autism spectrum?
I think that's a great question, and I think that's an area where we've had tremendous advances in recent years. I think we have become much more sensitive to the developmental framework, and I think we are much better now at using developmental information in how we target skills. Some of our assessment measures that we use now are much more developmentally normed now and developmentally sensitive, for example. And that is so important. We really do need to think about, well, what are the typically developing children of that age in that kind of setting? What kinds of skills are they exhibiting? What kinds of ways are they navigating situations? And we need to train to those. And I think that we need to be extremely sensitive to that and really be informed by that. Because to the extent that we can match those expectations of that environment and those developmental norms, we're much more likely to have the person be successful in that particular context.
And that's a great point. Though, interestingly enough, let me play a devil's advocate with you just a little bit. How do you respond to people that say, well, why do we want to train everybody to be like all the other five-year-olds? Maybe we should just train the world to be much more tolerant of the idiosyncratic, sometimes annoying, sometimes just idiosyncratic skills that people display on a day-in, day-out basis. Or do we need to do both? Train people to be more tolerant and also train skills that look like they're more likely to encounter reinforcement in most of the environments in which a child is operating?
Well, I think we want to think about how do we achieve socially significant outcomes? How do we help these learners have more positive interactions with their peers and caregivers? How do we have them have less negative interactions with their peers or with their caregivers? How do we increase their quality of life? And part of that quality of life increase is going to be the degree to which they are accepted, the degree to which they are invited in to join group activities. You know, in the world of childhood, it's all about social interaction. It's all about playing together. And to the extent that those behaviors stigmatize them, make people avoidant of them, or have people feel uncomfortable in their presence, we're limiting the opportunities for them to have those social bids from others. So I know what you mean, and we do have to try to make the world a better place and help peers become more tolerant and more understanding of some of the idiosyncrasies that they're likely to see. But I think we also owe it to the individuals with autism to help them become as integrated as they can be. And part of that equation includes having them learn to behave in ways that others are also behaving, so they have access to those reinforcing environments and experiences.
Sounds like a great perspective, approaching it from both sides, essentially. Now, you mentioned earlier manding as an example of a social skill. Are there other categories of social skills that you'd like to alert the viewers to in terms of what topics might we be concerned with in terms of social skill development?
Sure. I mean, I think broadly about a couple of different categories. So I think about social responsivity, training up individuals to be socially responsive to the overtures and bids of others. I also think about social initiations. That's a real deficit in a lot of individuals on the spectrum. Even when they're good responders, they're often not good initiators. And that's going to be limiting because that means that they need others to anticipate what they want. And we don't want them to be in that situation. We want them to be able to independently navigate those environments. In addition to that, I think about qualitative aspects of both of those responses, both social responsivity and social initiations, we have to make sure that the ways in which individuals are interacting with others are clear, are appropriate, are happening at a latency that is meaningful. You know, we don't want them to wait 10 seconds before they respond to a social bid from a peer. 10 seconds when you're a five-year-old is a very long time. Those social bids will be lost. So we want to look at time-based dimensions of behavior. That's another qualitative aspect of social responding. I like to think under this qualitative realm, too, about issues of endurance. Many individuals with autism are fine through one or two conversational exchanges, and then they're done. And then it ends, and they don't know how to sustain it, and they can't keep it going. And so I think we also have to look at endurance, being able to sustain an interaction, and especially as children age, when in fact conversations do become longer, we have to try to equip them with the skills to have more sustained topical conversations. And then in addition to all of those variables, I think we have to look at complex social behavior, which gets called by a lot of different names, you know, whether you call it social comprehension or complex social behavior or social understanding, sort of those broad skills that require social judgment and that require the understanding of social rules and the contextual relevance that comes into play with those social rules. I think that's another whole category that we've got to look at from an instructional perspective.
Well, Mary Jane, what you describe sounds like a complex, sophisticated set of behaviors that all fall under this broad umbrella of social skills and social perception. It's so broad that I'm wondering, where does the BCBA start? Is there an assessment approach that would help you identify where to start, where the major deficits are? And I understand you're saying also, make sure that you take a look at those deficits and make sure they match into this person's context, what's important for them, where it's going to improve their quality of life. But give us a little orientation about how do we begin to do some sort of, let's call it a comprehensive or systematic assessment.
Okay, sure. That's important. It all starts with assessment. We can't really get to treatment without an assessment of what those deficits are and where to begin. You know, it used to be that we really had no tools available to us from an assessment perspective, except ones that were homegrown at various centers. But in the last few years, we've had several excellent assessment resources that are really comprehensive in terms of thinking about getting a broad perspective on this individual and helping to do curricular planning for that individual. So two of the ones that have received the greatest attention are the ABLES and the VBMAP. And both of them have several sections that are very relevant to social functioning and to social skill development. And I think I recommend those as good places to start. Both of them have a significant focus on some of those core elements that we've already talked about as foundation skills. So you have manding as a long-term curricular progression. You have imitation as a long-term curricular progression. And so those are really important, both as fundamental starting places, but also as long-term curricular threads. So take, for example, all the resources that are now available to us in imitation planning. So I would include the VBMAP and the ABLES in there, as well as some of the work in A Work in Progress, for example, and in Crafting Connections, where they talk about various kinds of curricular sequences. So imitation starts with something as simple as you watching and doing when I do a simple gross motor task. But over time, we focus on goals that include sustained attention to a model so that you're now watching me do something for a period of time, not just for an instant. And over time, you're also precisely imitating something that I do. The difference between doing something with one hand versus two hands, or one finger versus the whole hand. Those are very important progressions in terms of looking at it as a response class. of imitation, of watching that individual evolve over time. And it may take several years of programming to get to generalized imitation at the level that we're hoping will really have a difference in a social skills realm. In the same way, manding. You know, sometimes people will say to me, oh, he mans. And I'll say, what does he man for? And they'll say, oh, he mans to go outside, and he mans for juice, and he mans for pretzels. And I think, well, how many things do you man for? Does that make you a good mander? Look at their typically developing peers and look at the, you know, wide array of things that they'll man for on a daily basis. And it's not just for desired items or desired activities. People man for attention. People man for escape. People man for information. So all of those things are things that we need to look at now from an assessment perspective, and we can with the tools that are available to us in those resources. And that helps to tell you, well, where is this person right now in that area of social skills instruction? And also, where are they going over time? And in addition to those things, there are social skills areas of both the ABLES and the VB map, and there are some school-relevant areas of those assessments, too, that help us understand things like ability to follow group instructions, to follow classroom routines. Those are extremely relevant environmental navigation skills that are social in nature. So I think we have a lot of resources available to us compared to what we had in the past that I think help prioritize a clinician. Where are we in the foundation, fundamental skills like manding and imitation and play? And then what else do we need to look at in terms of this individual's social skill ability, school relevant skills, group instruction skills?
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like there's a pretty good set of tools out there for doing assessments. And if I understand right, some of those assessments involve kind of structured assessment probes.
Yes.
Some may also involve a little less structured observations, like
yes.
observing a child playing with other children or something of that nature. One thing I should probably ask about assessment is, in the behavior analysis area, a fair amount of what we do derives from doing a functional behavior analysis or assessment. Now, here my question is, here we're dealing with a lot of behavioral deficits oftentimes. Is it real important to think along the lines of functional behavior analysis in this area, Mary Jane? Or does simply the documentation that, boy, we're missing a number of social skills, is that enough to get us started and say, yeah, let's focus on those with some evidence-based behavioral interventions?
Well, that's an interesting question. I would say, for the most part, most of the time, probably the resources that are available to us are enough. But are there the occasional children or adolescents that you would encounter where there's been so much experience with contingencies that have shaped behavior that is not ideal in the social skills context, where we do need to look at it more from maybe a functional behavior assessment perspective? For example, have they utilized certain skills to escape social interaction? Have they obtained social attention through aberrant behavior? So it happens where you might have an individual who presents with those behaviors to a much greater extent, and so it's all commingled together, and it's going to be difficult in those situations for you to make social skills progress without looking at it at the same time from a behavioral excess perspective.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like what you're saying, if I can reframe it a little bit, is that especially when you see social skill problems of the behavioral excess, inappropriate
yes.
skills, that's when it becomes especially important to do some sort of a functional behavior analysis, and maybe a little less important with the behavioral deficits where you're simply building a repertoire. Is that a fair way to
say
it?
That's my opinion.
Okay.
I mean, you might hear different things from other people.
I'm just curious, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, because, you know, a lot of behavior analysts have been trained to say, well, we need to do a functional behavior analysis before we start things. But my sense is that this is an area where you can simply say, let's start building the building blocks for this repertoire. And if and only if we get to inappropriate or excess behaviors, then we may need to go back and say, let's do a functional behavior analysis to understand
yes.
the function and the appropriate replacement behaviors. So
that's what I would say.
Okay. It sounds perfectly reasonable, obviously, okay? So anyhow, you've done some of these assessments now. Now move us into the treatment approach. How does a behavior analyst approach treatment? Do you do it in a group of children? Do you do it in a group of similar age peers? Do you do it one-to-one with modeling? What is in our armamentarium of how do you deliver effective behavioral interventions for a child with social skill problems?
Well, the first part of the message that I want to deliver is that we have a lot of instructional procedures that are evidence-based and that have been shown to make real-world differences in the social skills of individuals with autism. And that's such an important part of the message because so much of the message is sobering and does give us pause about how big a mountain it is to climb to try to impart social skills to this population. But the good news is that we really have a lot of very well-vetted evidence-based procedures. Most of those procedures are taught to individuals in structured, individualized, direct instruction formats. So they might be taught in a discrete trial format, or they might be taught in a naturalistic instructional framework, but they are generally taught in more individualized ways and then extended into group situations. Now, one of the things that's a challenge for us as behavior analysts is making sure that we keep ourselves focused on what our real outcome here is in the realm of social skills. We have to be focused on transfer to the natural environment, on demonstration of the behavior in generalized contexts, on spontaneous display of the behaviors. Often we're teaching in much more contrived contexts. And we may be contriving opportunities throughout the context of the day and taking data in contexts that are not entirely naturalistic or unplanned. But we have to also hold ourselves accountable for assessing transfer to the natural environment. Because unless we demonstrate transfer to the natural environment in the realm of social skills, we're not making socially significant change.
That makes perfectly good sense. I mean, this are a set of skills that have to be out in the natural environment where they make a difference for the child, obviously. Can I ask what is, in some ways, a fundamentally challenging question? Some of the social skills we're talking about produce specified reinforcement, like the man say, "Can I please have a cup of water?" That produces a type of reinforcement. But it's also the case that some of the social skills theoretically should be reinforced by social interaction. Now, do we have a concern here in the autism spectrum about how do you get social interaction to be an effective reinforcer? Is there anything that we need to be worried about there? Because, you know, even if you train it in a context, you know, which is fairly contrived, we're looking to get it to occur in a naturalistic setting. Is there anything we need to be thinking about? How do you get social interactions to be more reinforcing?
That's a good question. And I think that there's variability among individuals in the spectrum in terms of social motivation. Let's say prior to intervention, some children are much more socially interested. Some children are much easier to engage socially than others. With intervention, of course, the pool of individuals that are socially reinforced increases. So the more we work on these skills, the more motivated they become and the more socially engaged they become. So while you will have variability, I think it's really important not to make an assumption that this won't ever be motivating to that individual. Because I think very often we are surprised by the extent to which individuals do become socially motivated.
Mm-hmm. That makes perfectly good sense to me. Part of also the issue is that some of the social interactions also eventually lead to and get paired with other types of reinforcement. So you develop friendships with people and you go swimming or sailing or to get an ice cream or whatever else it may happen to be. So I can see that a lot of these things would kind of build into improving the reinforcing efficacy of the social interactions also.
Exactly. Okay, exactly.
Right. Okay, now, you talked about starting out with contrived settings and kind of contrived therapy strategies. Are there any particular strategies that you would recommend, Mary Jane?
There are a number of strategies that have been really shown to produce robust changes in individuals with autism. And there's quite a few of them. Just to name a few of them, video modeling. Video modeling's been shown to really teach a wide variety of skills in ways that are very effective and do generalize into natural contexts, including in the realms of play and conversation. Now, given how evidence-based it is, it's a bit surprising that out there in the clinical world, we don't see it utilized as much as you would think.
Why is that?
I'm not sure, but I have a theory that it's response effort. You know, who's going to make the videos? Especially because we emphasize things like the importance of variability in the videos, the importance of flexibility. We may not want to have just one way of exposing the person to video modeling. We might want to have several versions of that so that they don't become too reliant on one particular example of this skill. So that's more response effort. Now we have to make a wide variety of videos. So I don't know if that's the reason, but I do think that it's a formidable challenge. And I think that, you know, it just often is not done.
And there's not a commercially available video modeling series for children that focuses on social skills, all the different ways to ask someone a favor.
There are some.
All the different ways to say, please don't do that, it's annoying to me.
Right.
So there are some out there.
There are some out there, and people do use them. But, you know, there's also some evidence and a lot of opinion that it's probably better if it's individualized to the child, if it uses real-life scenarios from their experience and environments and people familiar to them. And so you could use those commercially available materials, and some of them are quite good, but very often people also feel that they should be making ones that are more relevant to the child.
So make them the specific and idiosyncratic to the child's social skill deficits and the context in which those social skills need to be.
Which makes sense.
That does make very good sense. Now, naively, do you just show them the video? What do you do?
So usually what people do is they have them watch the video and then demonstrate what was done in the video. So it's basically imitation training via video. So often it's following a play script, for example, watch the way someone works with this firehouse or garage or whatever it might be, and then duplicate that with your own materials. So kind of building sequences of actions in a play context or in a conversational context.
Does it require a prerequisite skill that you have to have at least some imitative repertoire?
So that's a great question that I don't think we have an empirical answer for, although a lot of people have been writing opinions on that. And yeah, I think it makes sense that that wouldn't be the place to start without an imitative repertoire and without a certain level of attending behavior.
So if you're going to be using video modeling, it certainly helps to have some prerequisite imitative skills so you can imitate the repertoire that you're seeing right there. Are there any downsides, side effects of using some of these videos? Is it possible that people would learn the videos by rote and just state them whether they're contextually appropriate or not? And if so, do you have any advice on how to get around that?
It is possible. That's a problem with another evidence-based procedure too, which is scripts. So teaching individuals conversation via scripts is another wonderful strategy that has a lot of support behind it. But like video modeling, has this issue of, are you teaching to the script? Will this person perseverate on the script, which some individuals with autism do? In both of those scenarios, whichever instructional procedure you're using, if you program in variability and novelty, that generally is avoidable.
Okay. And to do that, do you say, do it a different way?
Yes.
Or do you say, here's multiple exemplars
on my
video?
We generally use multiple exemplars.
Yeah.
So you might have multiple scripts. You might have multiple exemplars. If you were working with someone on a script, you would deviate from the script yourself so that they would have to respond to a slightly different, introduction by you.
Mm-hmm. And when you do this with, let's say, using the video modeling or even the scripts, do you typically have a similar age peer that they're interacting with as though they were I guess it makes sense to whatever the right context is, you have the right person to talk with, right? Or do you typically have a peer that you have to train?
You can train peers. Many people do it with adults. There's some controversy about that. You know, should it always be peers if it's a skill you want them to do with peers? Would they attend better to peers? And many people have a strong preference for peers. Of course, it's generally easier to control instructional variables to a greater extent when we're working with adults. And so sometimes people start with adults and then move to peers when the skill has been developed to some extent. And that seems to be a compromise that many people are comfortable with.
Makes good sense. Almost like the training wheel approach, obviously. You start off with a lot of structure and you gradually reduce that structure, looking for the skill set to generalize to the more socially appropriate context, working and interacting with peers, for example.
Right.
Okay. So you mentioned video modeling. Social scripting you mentioned briefly. Do you want to explain what that is also, Mary Jane?
Sure. So I mentioned that one of the issues that a lot of individuals with autism have is an issue of endurance, of being able to do a quick greeting, maybe a back and forth exchange of a couple of times, and then they're out of material. And it's very difficult for them to talk about things unless they have a special interest, which they'll then fall back on, which is not always socially appropriate. So we have to work on ways to get individuals to have topical conversations for sustained periods of time that mimic what is expected of others in social environments and contexts. And so one of the things that's been shown to be very, very successful is to systematically use and fade scripts so that individuals follow a script that keep them in a back and forth conversational exchange to be built up over multiple exchanges and to fade out the supports and to build in that novelty, flexibility, and variability that we talked about with video modeling so that eventually the person is able to go back and forth over multiple exchanges with just a basic framework to pull them along, but able to manage some variability and novelty.
So it ends up being a script with broad outlines, essentially.
Yes.
Now, when you're using the word script, is it are you using it the way we would think about like a movie script? Like this is a written...
Often, it's a textual cue.
A textual cue.
Where the whole sentences would be written out for the individual. Sometimes people will fade that very systematically, either literally fading it in terms of how visible it is, or fading back one word at a time. There's a variety of different procedures we could use within behavior analysis to systematically fade. But the idea is to give them that support initially while the skill is being developed, and then fade that support as they begin to be able to demonstrate the skill.
Because you don't want them to have to rely on scripts for the rest of their life, essentially.
Exactly.
Yeah. So those sound like both two pretty promising strategies. And I like both of them. Let me ask you one other potential downside of the video modeling. Does it worry you that people might not discriminate good versus unacceptable models? By that, what I'm talking about is there's a lot of stuff on popular television and popular media. And you go, well, is that the social skill I like people to learn by watching? Is that another kind of side effect you need to be vigilant for so that people learn to model mainly the things that are socially appropriate?
That's interesting. I think it's a problem that we probably don't encounter as much as you would think. We don't have a large group of individuals with autism that then just suddenly start watching and doing everything that they're exposed to. If they did, they'd be great generalized imitators, which is, not that easily achieved. But I would say this, I know what you mean in that clinically over the years, I've seen quite a number of individuals that have a particular propensity toward the negative example. So I've noticed some kids in role plays, for example, in behavioral rehearsal kinds of interventions, where it became clear clinically that we should not have this person ever practice the non-example, that we should have them only practice the example. Or in some cases, we wouldn't even expose them to the non-examples because they would perseverate on and continually practice the erroneous response. So I think it's always the case that we have to individualize. That's always our mantra, right? Everything we do at the level of the individual. And so if you have a learner that seems particularly vulnerable to that, I think I would proceed with extra caution.
Mm-hmm. And that's probably just a good generic warning for people. Every now and then, the challenges of raising children smack you right in the face, even if you're a behavior analyst. You go, where did you come up with that word? Well, I heard it from you, Dad. Or where did you come up with that approach? Well, I got it from my friends because they were all doing that sort of thing. Right. So it is interesting.
You're
about how do you
right.
inoculate people or get them to discriminate good examples versus unacceptable examples.
And sometimes we could teach that as a specific skill. That could be a discrimination task. That could be a target of instruction. What are the behaviors to emulate? What are the behaviors not to emulate? Should I copy this person? Should I not copy that person? And I think that that can be a target of instruction too.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like then that then follows up with what is the type of feedback and corrective feedback you need to give to people as they're practicing these skills. So you've talked about the antecedent side to a certain degree. Here's a script, here's a video model, and then people engage in the behavior. Do you typically build in some sort of structured feedback, or do you have them look at a video of themselves engaging
Absolutely.
In the behavior? How do you then do the rehearsal and the fluency training and all that sort of stuff?
Right. I think, you know, we can rely on some procedures that we know really work in terms of a behavioral skills training type of model as it's applied to this skill set. So we know that what works is actually having people demonstrate, practice, and receive feedback on their skills. So that same mentality needs to come into this work too. So we need to provide people with models. We need to then have them practice and get coached through that with feedback that's very specific from us. And we need to take that model into the social skills realm. I love the idea and have often done self-monitoring of this so that the individual can watch and observe their own behavior and say, did you do what you were supposed to do? And rate their own behavior in that context. Because I think that these are the sorts of things that are hard for people to learn, not just to identify in others, but especially to identify in themselves. So I think providing practice opportunities for those skills is really important. And I think many individuals on the autism spectrum can learn those skills.
It's interesting that you're describing some of that feedback is mediated by maybe the therapist or the BCBA, but some of it is a discrimination and evaluation repertoire. The behavior also has to apply to looking at his or her own behavior.
Yes.
So it sounds like there's a kind of a combination that goes in there.
Definitely. I think it's easier to teach these things first as identifying it and second as practicing it. When you get into some of those complex discriminations, I think when you mix those things with some learners, it's too complex. That when they're trying to both identify the correct or incorrect behavior and practice it, it gets into a big mess. But that if you can pull out, okay, we're going to teach you the discrimination, you're going to identify it, then you're going to practice it. I think that sometimes that's a strategy that can work with learners who are struggling more with those discriminations.
Part of what you're saying sounds to me like you need to think along the lines of how do you shape more sophisticated, longer, more complex skills. Am I correct
totally.
In that? I mean, and if you perhaps aren't making as much progress as you'd like, maybe you want to back it down to something that's a little simpler. Maybe a shorter interaction, then you'd only build it up later on, or a simpler response.
Exactly.
So, and that would also be part of the armamentarium of behavioral procedures, it sounds like.
Exactly. Sometimes before I will do role plays, I'll have them identify it in characters, in puppets, where nothing else is going on. I can make this incredibly salient between these two individuals, and this puppet has their back to the other puppet. You can learn to identify that pretty easily as a response we don't want. And we can also have them fix that, make them face the individual. And that can be even easier than identifying it in two people role-playing it. So I think there are so many ways in which we can back it up and take it to the most concrete, salient level possible. And then very slowly increase the degree to which it's a bit more subtle.
I never thought about using puppets. That's an interesting strategy. Mm-hmm. And it turns it into a simple interaction, perhaps.
And a simple discrimination.
Simple discrimination. And then the basic idea is that then generalizes
yes.
to more realistic interactions.
Exactly.
So that sounds pretty darn good. Great. Now, we've talked about maybe three different big behavioral procedures here. Kind of a discrete trial, sort of natural environment, structured training, some video modeling, and some social scripting. Mm-hmm. Is there anything else that you want to at least put on the table for people to consider? Or are there any interventions that are popular out there that you are not convinced that they yet have adequate evidence to suggest they would be efficacious?
Okay, so let me start first with an ABA. And one other thing I'd like to say about that is that we have been able to teach some of the hardest social skills to people with autism using behavior analytic procedures. So some of the work that's been done, for example, in the area of joint attention. Joint attention was a hot topic for a long time. We clearly identified it as a central deficit in autism, the ability to respond to social bids for joint attention or to initiate joint attention. There's been some very fine work done by a number of researchers, including Bridget Taylor, who's really looked at, can we use behavior analytic strategies to teach those skills? And yes, we've been able to do that.
Can you, before you move off of joint attention, can you give our viewers an example so that the concept of joint attention is pretty clear?
Sure. So when people think about joint attention, they often think about toddlers. Toddlers, even pre-vocal toddlers, spend half their life in joint attention activities. Pointing up to the airplane in the sky as they're walking down the street with their mom. They always are trying to involve other people in their social experience. When anything noteworthy is happening in their environment, they're trying to bring someone else in to share that experience. And when others want them to notice something, they eagerly engage in that. That is largely absent in individuals on the autism spectrum. And it's kind of been pointed to as one of those core deficits that seems to really be universal almost in individuals on the spectrum. And so one of the things that's kind of exciting is that we've been able to show that using behavior analytic teaching strategies, we've been able to impact on that, even though it's a core universal deficit that we don't see evolve naturally in individuals with autism. And some of the work that's been done in that area, I think, is so interesting and ingenious because it's kind of captured the essence of joint attention. In the work that Bridget Taylor did, she had very surprising things happen. You know, a SpongeBob fall from the ceiling, for example. Because that would be the kind of context where we'd want to see individuals go, oh, you know, look at that. And so I think part of it is making sure your teaching interactions actually reflect the context that you want this behavior to occur in. You know, I wouldn't say to you like, you know, look at computer. That's not interesting from a joint attention perspective. So we also have to be thinking about how do we teach it in ways that really transfer to the natural environment.
Mm-hmm. And in the social skills area, tell us why joint attention is so important.
Well, joint attention is so crucial because so much of later social interaction rests on that ability to both bring others into your world and what you're attending to and join others when they're asking you to notice something about their environment or their experience. So it's sort of a bridge into shared experience.
Shared experience, yeah.
And that's why we need to get there.
So that's one of the fundamental skills, and there are behavior analytic procedures that improve joint attention, it sounds like.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Similarly, there's been some work done in the area of perspective-taking skills from a behavior analytic perspective by Justin Leaf and some of his colleagues, where they've actually been able to systematically and very concretely teach someone how to identify what someone's looking at. So, for example, if I had three different candy bars in front of me and I was looking at this one, you would know that I want that one and you could answer that question. That's something that individuals on the autism spectrum generally can't do. They're not looking for social information at that level. And that's one of the most concrete forms of perspective taking, that you could understand that information about me from where I'm looking. And they've developed a really lovely series of procedures for systematically teaching those skills in ways that lead to acquisition in those areas. So what is exciting about those things is those are big buzzwords in the last decade, perspective taking or theory of mind, joint attention. And they've been touted as these core deficits and kind of suggested as maybe not too mutable out there in sort of the general literature about autism. And I think what's really exciting is that we have procedures within behavior analysis that have been shown to lead to skill acquisition in those areas. We still have a long way to go. We still need better demonstrations of the generalizability of those findings, but we've started and it's exciting.
Well, it sounds like interesting progress is going on, and I can see how that all fits into the social skills area, obviously. Well, Mary Jane, you've given us a wonderful overview of a number of evidence-based behavioral interventions, including discrete trial, natural environment training, social scripting, video modeling, and a little bit of work on the joint attention and perspective taking. As a behavior analyst, you probably get parents coming to you asking about other types of interventions. Are there any other types of popular interventions out there that you'd like to cover, either evidence-based or areas where you may have some concerns about the level of evidentiary support?
I'm glad you asked that. And I think that a lot of that originates in misconceptions about applied behavior analysis and what applied behavior analysis can do for social skills interventions. And I feel like many people think that applied behavior analysis is great for the less complex skills, but that when you're in the realm of social skills, ABA is not as relevant. And that's just not true. You know, we can address those complex skills just as well as we can address the simpler skills. And I often think, you know, who better than us who can analyze things systematically and step by step to address some of those more complex, nuanced skills. But I do feel like there is a general misconception about that, and people don't understand the utility of our science for that, and they don't understand all the procedures that we do have available that have shown such promise, like you summarized. What I do also see, and I do have some concerns about, is the proliferation of other strategies that are not evidence-based, but that proclaim to have the potential to make real-world differences in social skills. And I think that behavior analysts are definitely going to encounter them in their careers. And I think it requires some skill in understanding what the literature base is for those particular interventions and what it is not, and also helping our consumers to understand what the evidence base is for those procedures or what the lack of evidence might be. So, of course, those are procedures that could have emerging literature come out in the years to come. So we always have to be open to the data. We always have to let the data speak. And a procedure that we could say today doesn't yet show merit could one day be shown to be effective or could be changed in a way that would make it more effective. But at this point in time, some of the procedures that are used most commonly and that really don't have those interventions include social stories and the social thinking curriculum. And I think that we need to be aware of the level of evidence that exists for those procedures. Social stories has been studied more over time. Social thinking is a much newer curriculum about which there's a lot of interest. But social stories has been around for some period of time, and a number of studies have been conducted. One of the issues is that often social stories are done as one component of a packaged intervention, and it's difficult to isolate the impact of one of those procedures or another. But a recent review of the literature on social stories was rather sobering in terms of the percentage of studies that have been published that have been able to show a functional relation between social stories and social skills outcomes. Less than 10% of the studies have actually demonstrated a functional relationship. And so I think that's important for us to know as behavior analysts, that, you know, that what the data actually are saying, we need to be sensitive to. If in fact it's being used as part of a component package, what are we doing to assess the potential impact of that component for that learner? Are we making data-based decisions about the use of the continuation of these procedures? And so I think that that's something that's hard to do because we may be the only member of a team or the only person in the room who might have concerns about that intervention. But I think it's important in the interests of efficiency and effectiveness that we really stay close to the science in that context.
Well, you know, you make an interesting point here, and that is you point out that the absence of evidence doesn't mean there will always be no evidence.
Right.
It means simply that you don't have evidence that something works. And if I understand correctly, part of your concern is absent evidence of efficacy, and we have all these other interventions over here that do have evidence of efficacy and they work well, why not focus on those?
Exactly.
It might be taking
people... Let's allocate
people,
our responding over
yeah,
there.
Yeah, allocate our responding to this set of materials over here.
Yes.
And wait till the research comes online, or maybe the research in the future will prove that it doesn't work.
Exactly.
But those are still questions that are out as of now. And your point here about, gosh, less than 10% are showing causal relationships with a particular intervention, that would put it on the red or yellow flag list for me, saying that maybe that shouldn't be where we put our resources, essentially.
Exactly. And, you know, those are data that should affect our decision-making as clinicians. And so I think it's really important to stay on top of the evolution of those data as time goes on and adjust our clinical recommendations to be in line with that.
That makes perfectly good sense to me. Okay. Let me ask you to kind of pull out your crystal ball for a second, okay, Mary Jane, and ask you, where are our gaps right now in our understanding of behavior analysis and social skills? Where do we need to be going? What do you see as our agenda for the next 5 or 10 years of areas we need to work on, develop, and are you optimistic about where we're heading?
I'm optimistic. I'm very optimistic. I think we have some very substantial strategies that have really stood the test of time and have a lot of potential to make real-world differences in the lives of people with autism. I also think that we are well poised to address some of the challenges of generalization and transfer to natural settings. I think that in the years to come, we'll see many more demonstrations of those kinds of effects of some of our instructional procedures. I also think that we will turn our attention to some of the underserved populations in our research literature and our clinical interventions. For example, I think we need to do more for the non-vocal communicators. They need social skills too. It's harder for us to figure out how to equip them with those social skills. There are many more issues in figuring out how to make them effective communicators in that way. But we need to do that. We need to bring that technology to them in that way too. And I also think we need to give much more attention to adults on the spectrum and how we can address their social challenges so that we can reduce the likelihood of them being bullied or victimized or get in other kinds of difficulties because of their difficulties in navigating social demands and situations.
Well, it sounds like we have a promising state of affairs and still a challenging agenda for the future.
Definitely plenty of work to do.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Mary Jane. This was a wonderful orientation to behavior analysis assessment and treatment strategies and the rationale for doing social skills training. I'm looking forward to seeing where we go over the next few years and improving the social skills and quality of life associated with those social skills for children, adults, and adolescents on the spectrum. Thank you very much, Mary Jane.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.